Album Club this week to finish us off comes from Bush with Razorblade Suitcase. So first up, I'm going to ask you, Steve, 16 yeah. Stone was the album that came before it. So before we go on the journey of Razorblade Suitcase, give us the 411 on that album. How would you describe 16 Stone to anyone who has not only not heard that album, but not heard this band? Because, you know, we are going back 20 years, 21 years. Fucking hell. Like, this came out in 1996. So,
yeah. Yeah. Well, it's, I guess it's, you know, the all the things that were sort of chucked at Bush about grunge light and grunge chances and stuff. Like, it's fair to say that 16 Stone is not the most original album. But as a debut record, you're talking about, like, I, as a kid growing up, first hearing it, fucking loved that record.
Plus one.
Like, so many... All the hits, basically. Well, not all the hits, but, like, the majority of it sounds like hits.
Radio-friendly early 90s friendly, alternative rock.
Very, like, pretty simple, you know. Do you know what I mean? Like, there's not a lot of bells and whistles going on that record, but it was enough for, at that time, them to capture the imagination of the American record-buying public.
And sell 6 million copies.
And sell 6 million copies, which was much to the head-scratching of every fucking shit Britpop chancer in Britain at the time.
Well, yeah, I mean, they got signed in by a guy in America. They released the album in America, and it took ages for them to even agree to release it here. Is it fair to say that Bush's sound... because they are called Bush because Shepherd's Bush. Yeah. Just in case you didn't know.
Well, he's actually come out recently and said apparently that's not true.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I don't know what it is, but yeah, that's what I was thought
it was. To be cited. Yeah, well, that's what they used to, that's what they used to say back in the day anyway. Yeah. Right. So anyway, like, this isn't very British sounding, especially not on 16 Stone, where it was super polished. Now, you touched on it there. Credibility with Bush. Always an issue. Mm-hmm. It was always the main front and centre issue. They, to the point where they went on the cover of Rolling Stone in 1996, and the cover line on the fucking front cover said 3 million albums, 5 hit singles, Bush. Why won't anyone take Gavin Rossdale seriously? They also, in the review for this next record that we are going to talk about, Razorblade Suitcase, called them the Bon Jovi of grunge. And they were voted, Razorblade Suitcase was voted the worst album of 1996 by Rolling Stone. Mm-hmm. But take that with a pinch of salt, because second on that list was Pinkerton by Weezer, which was in my top 20 albums of all time.
Oh dear, and they've been backtracking ever since.
Yeah, I bet they bloody have. So, with the bands that I grew up with, I kind of understood why the press didn't like Limp Bizkit and Papa Roach and Linkin Park and a lot of those kind of bands. The Offspring, no matter how they're heralded as heroes now, were always derided and belittled in the press. And I always kind of understood it, because all of those bands are kind of cartoony. Why did Bush take a kick in? Why?
Because... one, it's not...
I've got a theory, but...
it's not very British from our side of the pond. You weren't supposed to do that as a British band.
Because Britpop was in full effect.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? We're talking about 94 and 96.
Britannia, Trainspotting, all those twats.
Britpops.
All that shit was going on. So you weren't supposed to do anything apart from, you know, don your Union Jack sunglasses and sound like John Lennon. That's what you were meant to do, right? So
it's a great point. It's not one that I had.
Yeah, so there's that, I think, is the first one. Also, they were successful without the help of any of those people.
Yes.
So that's...
and the media have always had a bee in their bonnet about that.
Furious. Yeah. Absolutely furious.
We didn't sanction this.
Yeah, do you know what I mean?
I agree.
The NME, how come you sold 7 million records when you've never been in the NME? Mm. Like, you know, fuck off.
If I remember rightly, when Gav was going on the cover of Kerrang around this time, like, the preview and the photo the week before, I'm paraphrasing, but it was something along the lines of, this British man is the biggest rock star on earth and you might not know who he is.
Mm. Especially, like, if you watch The Voice.
Yeah.
I know that was
yeah,
now. Yeah. But it was a weird thing, because, I mean, I heard 16 Stone at school.
Yeah.
And I heard it because my 16 mate...
16 Stone is a... banger, by yeah, the way. Yeah, 16 Stone's well. A banger. Great.
My mate who played guitar, ended up playing guitar, wasn't at this time, but ended up playing guitar in my band. Like, we all liked Smashing Pumpkins, and all liked Sonic Youth, and we all liked, you know, the grunge, the cool grunge band, Pearl Jam and whatever. And you know, and then we liked Green Day and Offspring. But when we started hearing Silverchair and Everclear, like, as 15-year-old kids, I don't think we understood why we weren't meant to like them as well. Do you know what I mean?
See, my theory is exactly that. Is it maybe that they were second wave? Like, the second wave of anything gets a lot of backlash.
Yeah.
You mentioned Silverchair, who are a fucking brilliant band. Brilliant. Especially like, those first three records are all solid for me. But even a band as fucking brilliant as Stone Temple Pilots were part of this shit.
Yeah.
Like, was it just...
Pearl Jam got it from Nirvana.
Yeah, like, of course,
there's a...
corporate rock.
You know, Pearl Jam got it. Like, so, it's punk rock. It was, did anyone really know how to behave when punk rock took the mainstream? Because as we discussed in the Nirvana special, nobody saw that coming.
No.
And how could they ever have seen it coming? So... when all these other people are coming, you are going to go, I mean, fucking hell, if you think that, like, uppity punks get annoyed about, oh, look at now they're on the second album. You don't remember the first album. I've got the 7-inch EP.
Yeah.
Imagine that times 100 million. Mm. And that's what Bush and Stone Temple Pilots and Silverchair and Everclear and all these bands walked into. Like, yeah, of course. They got big off the back of Nevermind. That everybody did.
Yeah, I was about to say, but you can say that about Alice in Chains.
Yeah,
but
no one can say it about Green Day, about Offspring, you can say about fucking everyone.
So again, the other thing that I wanted to talk about before we get to Steve Albini, who produced Razorblade Suitcase, is so they were labelled Nirvana clones. Bush, that was the biggest thing. Number one, front and centre, the like family fortunes top answer was Nirvana clones. Does that hold water for you? Like, I hear, I mean, it doesn't take a musicologist to hear that the riff from Little Things is very similar to the Smells Like Teen Spirit riff. Only in the same way that the Offspring Self-Esteem is, but it is. Yeah. Like, does that hold water?
I mean, a little bit, but I mean, I think it's like...
is it not down to a little bit to both of those bands having, like, very pretty frontmen?
Raspy voiced pretty frontmen, who were quite melancholic, and you know, depressive. If you're one of those people, depressive.
I never got that vibe from Gavin Rossdale.
Really?
No, I thought I always thought he was.
Maybe we'll talk about it in a bit.
I always thought he was a bit Hollywood.
Yeah, but I think if you listen to a song like Glycerine on 16 Stone, if you listen to like
Come Down as well,
Come Down and stuff like that, they're, you know, like those are angst-ridden songs.
I see, angst. Right, okay, got you. Sorry, I was not following you down that cul-de-sac, but no, I understand where you're coming from.
Yeah, because when I say, like, I meant, like, people, depressing in it.
Got you.
You know, I mean, fucking hell, man, even Radiohead got shit for being, like, grunge at the time. Like, everyone who dared be born later than post-Nevermind and former band, you get the fucking shit for
and
it.
And, again, Radiohead...
Dave Grohl was getting it.
Again, Radiohead, another band that didn't fit Cool Britannia.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Yeah.
Steve Albini. The reason why I ask about the Bush being Nirvana clones thing is that it was after selling 6 million records and annoying the fuck out of the music press and cool people, right? On both sides of the Atlantic, picking Steve Albini... like he of Nirvana in Utero fame, to produce your record is bold, naive, silly. Like it, like there are a million. There are
both.
Hold
yeah.
on, no. There are different ways of pigeonholing that decision. I think it's bold because if that's the guy that you want to produce it, and they call you Nirvana clones, and this guy produced Nirvana, like, you are inviting a shitstorm. Yeah. And to me, that shows balls the size of boulders to go, fuck your shitstorm. Like, I want Steve Albini to produce this record. It's what's best for us, and I don't care what anyone's saying about it. That was my interpretation.
Yeah, me too. Like, me too, with the caveat that I wondered if Steve Albini was the right person to produce Bush.
Hmm. So he was picked not for his work on Nirvana, because like Rossdale was very open about the fact that that he obviously likes what Albini did with Nirvana. But the record that is really pointed at, and like apparently Albini and Rossdale got on like a house on fire during the making of this record because he was into like the Jesus Lizard and PJ Harvey and all that sort of stuff. But the album that was cited as the reason was Surfer Rosa by the Pixies and not Nirvana. Now, you're the Pixies guy of the two of us. Like, can you hear that, like, why they picked the guy that produced Surfer Rosa to produce the songs that went on to Razorblade Suitcase?
Yes, a little bit I can. Yeah, I can. Because there is... although it's actually, I was about to say, In Utero is a much more violent album than Razorblade Suitcase and with Surfer Rosa. But there are also songs like Penny Royalty and, I think the acoustic Penny Royalty. There are songs like All Apologies and Heartshaped Box where it is quite nicely. But there's much more of that kind of... we're talking about Steve Albini, so when I say lo-fi, I mean even by Steve Albini standards.
There's much
more of that kind of lo-fi, really airy, much more melodic but downbeat stuff on something like on Surfer Rosa that I think you can draw a direct parallel with, especially for the second half of Razorblade Suitcase, where it really takes
mellows out and a downward step.
Yeah, so I think if they wrote a song like, you know, like Mouth or whatever, I think they would have looked at Surfer Rosa and gone, well, yeah,
that makes sense.
What we're doing.
Okie doke.
Yeah, so it does, that on reflection does make sense.
Would you like to hear what Steve Albini had to say about this record?
Yeah,
retrospectively?
I would.
Steve Albini said, "I did an album in the 90s for the band Bush after they had a couple of big hits already. While we were working on their second album, they kept pursuing a particular song that I thought was the weakest and most derivative of the whole set of songs we were working on. A complete dog. Whenever they asked me my opinion, I would admit that this particular song struck me as disposable and they should concentrate on other stuff. In the end, they did a version they liked, which I still thought was a turkey, to coin your term.
Yeah.
That song was Swallowed, was released as the first single from the album, and it was also their first number one hit single. I apparently know nothing about what makes for hit records," is what Steve Albini had to say about working on Razorblade Suitcase. Swallowed. Now, Swallowed was a song that you could not move for on MTV, even in the United Kingdom, which is why I think Bush were, they were not quite the fucking unseeable band in the UK that you, like, history seems to dictate that they were, because they played Brixton Academy on this record.
They headlined Brixton Academy,
So, Swallowed. What's your take on Swallowed? When we talk about that, like, I got, to throw this out there, when we did Placebo's debut album on Album Club and we had that lovely time, I hadn't heard Nancy Boy in fucking ages.
Yeah.
So when we listened to it, you got why Nancy Boy was Nancy Boy.
Yeah.
It hasn't been overplayed in the 20 years subsequently. So it had literally been years since I heard Nancy Boy. And when you heard it, it was just like, oh man, it just felt so warm and good and great.
Mm.
Men from the 90s speak. But... Swallowed. I got the exact same thing going back on this record this week.
Yeah.
What a song.
Yeah, and I think as well, it's like, again, about things being overplayed, which we talk about a lot, because it hasn't. And also because, like, it was the first single, so it came out the week, but this is when you would go and buy the single the week before the album came out. And you wouldn't have heard it, you know, you didn't hear it until you bought the single. That would usually be, especially for a rock band, because it wasn't on the radio, it wasn't being teased on the radio.
New.
You bought it to hear it, because you're like, oh, the album's coming out next week, I can hear one song from it now, right? So I went out and bought the single, and I was like, this is fucking great. And then a few days later, they turn up on Top of the Pops. And as someone who... had been told for, you know, in my time of listening to, like, I loved Razorblade, particularly as a, like, just as a very brief thing, going back to 16 Stone.
Yeah.
the first girl that I thought I loved, I got 16.
Don't let the days go by.
Oh, so I was like, you know, I got that and was like playing, oh God, doing like to 16 Stone a lot.
I don't mean to laugh at your pain.
No, no, mate, it's fine.
But I'm imagining the 16.
I know, yeah. Pathetic little man. I was like, sad little man. I'd love to go back and give him a slap.
So fair.
You know, but I had, so I was always, I was going, I'm going to get the Bush album deck. I can't wait to get the Bush album. And people go, oh, no one's, you'll be the only, they'll only sell one copy. No one gives a fuck sort of thing. Like, so for it to get to number, what, number seven, I think?
Yeah, I think it charted quite
top
high.
Top 10, definitely top 10, to get in there. And like, it just felt like that song made me go, see, fuck you, rock. Because I was being, oh, rock.
I mean,
you know, grunge, shut up. It's rubbish. Like, no one cares anymore. Well, yeah, they do. In America, they do. And oh, looks like we do here as well.
And, like, another thing, just while we're on Swallow, because we haven't spoken about the song itself yet, but the video is fucking brilliant as well. Really, really brilliant.
I haven't watched back the video. I haven't watched
like,
the video.
Like, oh mate, I did it this morning. Yeah, like, after I listened to this record on the day that we recorded it, I was like, the video and that old woman with a really wide mouth. I should really go back and check that out again. Really, really fucking good and iconic. And I think to give Steve Albini his dues as fucking usual, is that fucking before like leading into the solo just fucking pierces the ears. And when the guitar solo kicks in, bang, like fucking really uplifting. When we've spoken about Razorblade Suitcase in the past, we've called it like an album of two halves. Mm-hmm. So let's do the first half first.
Yeah.
Let's call it Up to A Tendency to Start Fires. Includes Cold Contagious on the slower side of things, but let's call it like the first six songs. What's the defining characteristic of the first six songs? I'm going to throw it out there. I think the first six songs on this record is the best Bush ever got.
Ooh.
I prefer it to the, like, because the monolithic hit singles on 16 Stone, I appreciate.
Yeah.
But much like you, I like a bit of grit with my listening. Mm. And I love those songs. I really do love the songs on 16 Stone. Machine Head in particular is fucking like, oh man, I'm 13 again. Yeah. But like now, as an adult, I like the first half of Razorblade Suitcase. I like the second half as well.
Greedy
we'll discuss in that in a minute. Greedy Fly, the rhythmic like cadence and the building on Insect Kin is really brilliant. Yeah. Greedy Fly is great, apart from that kind of video that was done by the people that made Seven and looked like Seven.
I don't remember that.
Personal Holloway.
Personal Holloway, as an opener, that riff.
Like, I believe, I could be wrong on this, and it just goes to show what a fucking Bush nerd I was back in the day, but I believe Gavin Rossdale's dog was called Winston.
Yeah, you're right, you're correct.
Snarls at the beginning of it, and then that riff from Personal Holloway comes in like a wrecking ball, to quote Miley Cyrus. But yeah, like, it really does.
Yeah.
Fucking swings into action.
I was, when you said, I thought you were going to talk about the characteristics, because it's not one dimensional, but it is definitely, this is the heavy shit. This is the squealing shit. This is the like the discordant lo-fi horrible shit. But they've got such a good,
they opened with A Tendency to Start Fires at Reading, '97, did, yeah. And it was fucking so leery that day.
Have I ever said this about when I crowd surfed at Bush at the Reading Festival at that show at 1997 Reading?
No.
And yeah, because I didn't do much crowd surfing, but there was a lot of girls down the front screaming Gavin.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, I want to crowd surf, which I didn't do much.
Yeah.
And I fucking ended up landing on a bunch of like 14-year-old girls.
Oh,
like someone got thrown up, and I ended up sort of just clenching my fist because I thought I was going to break my back. And I heard loads of screaming, and people eventually like pushed me over.
Yeah.
And when I walked past the security around the back, I opened my hands, and in the palms of my hands I had about 8 different colours of hair. So 2 big handfuls of clumps of like young screaming Gavin Rossdale girl fans hair. And I was
apologies
like,
if that was one of you.
Sorry, girl. Oh God, I feel like a bit of a prick now. But like, it was a complete accident. But yeah, you're right. It was hilarious as fuck. And I saw them, it was actually the first gig I ever went to in London.
Oh,
it was
wow.
At Bush. at the Forum.
So the Three Colours
in London. No, that was a few months later. Right. I did go to that as well. That was really good.
Right.
But yeah, I went to see Bush and they opened with Personal Holloway.
Yeah.
And I mean, if memory serves me right, and it's not obviously not fresh in my memory, but yeah, it's embedded so sort of deeply in my memory that I think they started with Personal Holloway into Little Things into Everything Zen, into Greedy Fly.
Can't fuck with that. Cannot fuck with that at all.
It was pretty fucking impressive.
I do think in that first half of Razorblade Suitcase as well, I think Cold Contagious is my favourite of the slow songs that Bush have done as well.
Yeah.
I think it's such a mature and patient approach to songwriting, especially the middle bit where it really lets itself breathe with that... like just fucking really spacious so that when everything comes back in, it has maximum input. I think Cold Contagious is quite something. So when we were talking about this album the other week, because we've put this in because Gavin Rossdale's doing the voice, so it was a time to put it in and it to hold some relevancy. But you were quite sceptical, would be the word that I would say, half of this.
Yeah, I was.
Now we've gone back and revisited it, how do you stand by that? How do you feel about this?
I don't actually. Funnily enough, I think on reflection with a more mature ear, I'd like to think, I think they suit those songs very well. Because I always loved like Glycerin of 16 Stone.
Yes.
And I just felt like the second half of this album, to me, like as a kid, I wanted something fucking up and fizzy. Yeah. And you know, and I wanted the squalling feedback and the you know, the riffs and stuff. And there's not a lot of that on this record. But actually, because of Gavin Rossdale's voice and that, you know, he has got a really great tone to his voice. Like those slow songs, and with now more appreciative of the talents of Steve Albini as well, I have to say, they do work a lot better. Like I appreciate it a lot more.
I'll tell you what, right? Like, not 180 on what I said on it, because I agree. Like, the maturity on this record is so impressive for a second album.
Yeah.
I would say if you cut out Distant Voices, Communicator and History, you've got a 10-track, no filler in it whatsoever album.
Yes, yeah,
I think Mouth, Straight No Chaser, really underrated. And Bone Driven.
Actually, I always liked Straight No Chaser. That was the one that I always liked from that great, second man. Half.
And Bone Driven is the natural, older, more lamenting side of Glycerine.
Yeah.
Like just a bit less Steve crying in his bedroom.
Which is a perfectly valid artistic statement.
Real men crying, right? Yeah, right. I'm fucking standing by it. Yeah. So, yeah. They also, I guess to finish up the story of Razorblade Suitcase, because... they were the biggest band in America at this point in time. The only band who competed with them for the biggest band in America was No Doubt. And it just so happened that at the summer that these two bands blew up, they were on tour together. And that is where the whole Gavin Gwen thing started.
Wonder if Met My Wife.
Do you think it was...
That bit. Yeah.
Do you think that... do you think that that had something to do with the Nirvana thing as well? Although they'd had it, they'd had it up to that point. It felt like another stick to beat a band that were not the press's darlings.
Yeah, that's tenuous
at best. I agree,
it's fucking tenuous. And I think I shared this on your Facebook page today. I don't know if you've had a chance to watch it yet. The BBC Two documentary that aired.
Right. No, I haven't. No.
So
been
I think
busy today.
You should all go in on YouTube. There is a documentary from that first February UK tour. So they actually toured, they played London.
We'll put the link up on the Facebook page.
Yeah, they played London the week after Razorblade Suitcase came out. Mm-hmm. And they did a bunch of UK shows. They show them like following them on tour. So they show them at Nottingham Rock City.
Right.
And you can see like they've got a pretty meagre bus and they're not acting like massive rock stars, not acting like massive dicks. And
everyone says that that's Rossdale's vibe, is that he's just chill. I mean, he comes across very LA, which is to be understood if you lived most of your life there, like most of your adult life there. But everyone's reports on the guy always says down to earth.
Yeah.
I've never had the pleasure, actually.
And no, me neither, but it's a really interesting... Like, I've not watched it for a long time, but I remember being really like... they don't feel like Nirvana, mm-hmm. but they don't feel like, I guess, what Creed were going to become.
Yes.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like, they
of course.
Didn't come across like that at all.
Right.
And there were bits where he was signing autographs to like Screaming Girls and he was a bit like, huh, I don't normally get this here, sort of thing.
Yeah.
And that's one bit I do remember after Nottingham Rock City, like Robin the drummer signing autographs yes. and going, this has literally never happened to me in this country before.
Bass player was in Transvision Vamp in the 80s.
He
well.
Was, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's a really good documentary and it ends with them flying off to America and you see footage of them playing in America in massive fucking
yeah,
arenas.
Huge
fucking arenas. But it's really interesting as a snapshot of cool. like just as the pendulum was about to sort of swing into them being a something here.
How do you feel about subsequent albums? Any of them?
I like the song Chemicals Between Us.
Yeah, it's good. I liked bits of The Science of Things. I didn't really like Golden State at all.
They've got a new one which I own and I've literally never listened to once.
I can't
weird,
remember. Yeah, I did listen to it.
State of Euphoria.
I didn't go back for the live shows because Bush were a band to me and Nigel wasn't there and I don't think Robin was. No, Robin was there. It's the bassist that weren't there
Dave.
As well. So yeah, that is Bush's Razorblade Suitcase, a super interesting album from the '90s, and again. Both of those first two Bush albums, all gold, man. Well worth your time.
Yeah.
Especially if you like Super Heaven and like those kind of bands, like Bush would have been still at the forefront of it today. I think the biggest testament to those first two Bush records is that if they came out with 2017's production, if either of them came out this year, Bush would still be fucking massive all over the world.
Yeah. And I
can't
think
fuck with those songs, man.
I think, and also, like, if you're young and you've never listened to them before and you just know them as a bit of a joke,
yeah.
I think now's a good time to go back and listen to them and sort of reevaluate. Or, like, if you listened to them and thought they were a joke back in the day, to go back and listen to them. And I don't think that they are. I mean, I can understand they're certainly a lot more basic than Silverchair.
Yeah.
They're certainly a lot more simplistic than even the Foo... You know, they certainly have less strings to their bow than even, like, the Foo Fighters on those first couple of records.
Yeah.
But... they've got some fucking killer songs.
Yeah, and yeah, I do really think that they deserve their place as
yeah.
one of the like the big bands from the '90s.
Yeah.
Underrated and criminally so, Bush. So that was Bush's Razorblade Suitcase, the latest on Album Club. That's Not Metal is powered by Marshall. Join us for new episodes every single Friday featuring the most honest reviews, savage opinions, and everything you need from the world of rock and metal. Go on to iTunes or SoundCloud and search That's Not Metal and subscribe today. Premium podcasts are available at thatsnotmetal.net. Come on over there and get our very best work. thatsnotmetal.net for premium podcasts. That's Not Metal, powered by Marshall, available on iTunes and SoundCloud.